99 patients in the stressed hyperglycemia group compared to 568 patients that were in the placebo. So here we see that in both groups, their age and sex were well matched. The functional tool score was higher. In other words, the patients who experienced stress hyperglycemia were sicker than those who didn't. And they also had a longer hospital length of stay as well as a higher in-hospital mortality. And this is concurrent with the current literature that's not surprising. We found that the mean adjusted HbA1c was slightly higher in the stress hyperglycemia group at 5.57% compared to that of 5.45% in the normal glycemia group. And even after adjusting for sex, age, and importantly, illness severity, we found that the difference between the two groups remains even at 0.1%. So we find that stress hyperglycemia is associated with higher HbA1c and possibly by inference increased future risk of developing type 2 diabetes. And although you might think that a difference of 0.14% between the two groups might sound a bit modest, then we can see epidemiological data published in about 7 years ago. You can see that in the category of A1C percent, once you jump onto the next category between 5.5 and 6%, so this two categories are the ones we're interested in. You almost have a double double chance of developing incident diabetes in the future. So it's not a linear relationship. So the sort of modest absolute difference may translate to an actual clinically apparent difference in the life population. So we find that perhaps how we can apply this clinically is that we may need closer monitoring for incident type 2 diabetes in survivors of critical illness, perhaps doing a HbA1c 3 months down the track and see, looking for linear progression. If it's trending upward, then any closer monitoring than the usual population. And certainly with something like this has already been applied, for example, gestational diabetes, which is another acute physiological stress state with established and future social diabetes. However, this study is obviously limited because it's a single center study, as a retrospective observation analysis. And we didn't have data on BMIs, so we didn't have data on other diabetes risk factors.